Hello guys, my name is Isac and I am a lighting and environment artist here at Quixel Epic. In this video I will take you through my general set dressing and world building process for this abandoned apartment scene. If you haven't watched my previous video where I go through my general design process for this scene, I would strongly recommend you watch that before you watch this one, because a lot of the things I make in this are based on the planning that I talked about in the previous video. So, let's get started. As I mentioned in my previous video, I often start off a project by scanning through the Megascans library and favoriting assets that I think I might need later on. And now I can just pick the assets I want to use and hit download and export. Here you can see a little collection of all the man-made Megascans assets I used for this scene. To illustrate how I normally go about set dressing a scene like this, I have made a small replica of the hallway just to take you through my general workflow. So let's start off with these ceiling tiles. I wanted to be able to adapt the ceiling tile position so I could control how much light I could let into the room, and I don't want to have to run back and through and forth between Unreal and Blender, so what I did here was I imported them separately so I can move them around, and then when everything has a nice position, I just merge them into one mesh, and that's really a nice function because then you can save on draw calls, but you can still kind of adapt your environment inside of Unreal. And once I have a nice placeholder light, I start moving on to the actual set dressing. And just as I mentioned in my previous video, really study your reference photos and try to identify all the most essential details so that you can mimic them one-to-one in Unreal while still keeping a decent frame rate. For the walls, I decided to use the blend material that we ship with Bridge. I really love working with a vertex blend material because you can get a really high texture resolution since you can tile everything in a better way, but also because you can kind of adapt the textures of the assets in engine. You don't have to run everything back and forth through a mixer to get everything to look right. And once the wall's base material looks nice, I start giving everything a decal pass. If any of you guys have watched Victor Öhman's tutorial for his scary restroom scene, you will recognize this kind of workflow with using almost an excessive amount of decals to create that layered grime and dirt, and it's a workflow that I really come to love. I try to think about it as a painting where you paint the flat surface of the walls and then you layer more and more paint on top to give it all that fine detail, and it's basically the same kind of workflow here, just in 3D. So once the walls have a finish that I'm satisfied with, I start placing the actual 3D assets. And I keep coming back to my original concept art and my photo reference a lot when I do this, so I can make sure I don't deviate too much from my original plan. Here is also where we start making use of what we learned from the photo reference. When you're placing stuff like this, remember that often debris tend to accumulate in corners and along the walls, as opposed to just lying in the middle of the floor. Another thing to remember is that things rarely have like a 90 degree angle, so when you place stuff, remember to always rotate it. And also try to, in a way, tell a story with how you place your assets, because that's basically what this stage is all about. It's environmental storytelling. Imagine, for example, one of those pipes I just placed has burst and there's a lot of water coming out and it's created stains and leakage on the walls. Or maybe there are some papers on the table, for example. Like all of those small little things that tell stories about how this environment came to look like this. That kind of mindset when set dressing makes it so much more interesting. And I really think that you kind of see the result of that in the final set dressing, if you've actually taken some time to try and imagine who lived there and what it used to be and all of that. And as you can see, I don't really use the scatter tool at all for this process. And sure, doing it like the way I'm doing it, hand placing it, can be extremely time consuming. But I also think it's really important to allow this part of the process to be time consuming. Because if you just start scattering stuff without any thought into why things lie where they are and why these specific assets are there where they are, you kind of lose that whole storytelling part of the set dressing, which is super important. And you know, just like with the walls, when it comes to set dressing, layering is really, really key. You know, it's telling a story with the layering. You know, first it was just a floor, and then that's become damaged, and then there's like paper and rubbish and stuff on top of it, and then there are like dead plants, and then there are live plants. And all of that tells a story of how the environment has developed over the years. I also gave my 3D assets a very quick run through Mixer just to grime everything up and make it look a little bit more worn and old. A final thing that I think is important to mention here is that you can see that I reuse the same assets and textures quite a lot. And I think that's quite important, because when you're making a scene like this, it's not a question of the fidelity of one single asset or the texture resolution of a specific decal. It's to keep in mind that you work with the scene as a whole and not with one single asset. Thank you all so much for watching this video on set dressing. I hope you all enjoyed it, and be sure to tune in to my next video where I will be covering lighting in much more detail. If you have any thoughts or questions, be sure to write those in the comments of this video. And I look forward to seeing you next time.